Even men at the top of their game find themselves wanting more from life. Whether it's more meaning, unshakable confidence, a hotter sex life, a bigger impact, more money, deeper love, solid friendships, a powerful legacy. Find out how good you can have it on this episode of Man Alive. Head over to shaynajamescoaching.com/manalive to get outtakes, raw footage, and bonus videos you can only get there. You can also grab your copy of The Unknown Power That Accelerates Your Career and Solidifies Your Confidence with Women.
Welcome to this episode of Man Alive. Hi, Trip. I have Trip Lanier here with me.
Hello, Shayna. It's like we never talk anymore.
I know. So Trip and I have known each other for, I don't know, probably almost 10 years at this point, I would say.
I think so.
And we've done a lot of men's work together, facilitated workshops. It's been a ride, and we've seen all different sides of each other. One of the things I would say before I give you a more pro introduction is that I really trust you. I trust you with me, with my heart, with my vulnerability. And I trust you with other people. You know, I trust you when you're coaching people. I trust you to not bullshit people and to tell the truth and to say it like it is and to be in service, you know, versus trying to blow smoke up someone's ass.
Thank you. Yeah. That feels good. Yeah. Appreciate that.
So for those of you who don't know Trip, let me just do a brief intro and then we're going to keep diving in on the topic of bullshit and how it impacts our lives. So Trip is the host of the New Man podcast, Beyond the Macho Jerk and the New Age Wimp, which has been happening for probably a decade at this point, right? It's been downloaded millions of times.
Yeah, it's getting there. I think it's almost a decade. I'm not sure. Yeah.
We're getting old.
You are. I'm not. I'm immature, apparently. So.
Yes, right. So Trip also coaches entrepreneurs around the world to get out of what he calls the shallow end of the pool and really redefine success and align their work with what they're put on this earth to do. And over the years, he's designed several businesses to support a really simple lifestyle focused on freedom, ease, and fun. And he also has an amazing wife who I know as well and a beautiful daughter. So thank you again for being here.
Yeah, thank you. I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to support you. I've been a little behind the scenes watching you bring this to the world. So it's exciting to be on this side of it.
Yes. So where do we want to dive in? I mean, one of the things that, like I said, as I introduced you is to me, you bring a kind of love without bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things, as I thought about talking to you, that would be really valuable for men is this idea of, where are we? I'll include myself, right? All humans. Where are we bullshitting ourselves?
Me too. In our lives? Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Where are we bullshitting ourselves? Well, I would say it's anywhere where there's something that we want, and then there's this story that we create that it's going to be hard or uncomfortable, or it's just fear. Like there's the thing that I want, and then I can't go have it for whatever reason.
Yeah.
So I may want to get in shape, but I don't want to, you know, have to get up. I'll tell myself some things like I'll have to get up at certain crazy hours and it'll cost a lot and I won't be able to eat my favorite foods and I'll be uncomfortable when I go out to eat with other people. God. So fuck it. I'm not going to do it.
Blah, 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 blah.
So there's bullshit, right? That's a facet of it. I've been married for X years and sex life is stale. And I want to do something different, but there's no way I can bring it up because my wife will never go along with blah, blah, blah. And she'll freak out and think, right. And then terrible things happen, blah, blah. So we could go on and on. We all have these different things, but if it becomes just, I want more money. I want more sex. I want better X, Y, Z in life. It's just anywhere where we have a growth edge and there's something that we want, then you can expect bullshit to be front and center.
Do you actually expect it to be front and center?
I expect it. Yeah, of course I expect it. It's just like, okay, well, where is it? Like, it's just going to be there. It's not like it's not going to be there. It's just going to be there. And the world that I live in is and I work in with people is that it's an extension of our fear. I'm scared, but I don't want to say I'm scared. So I create a story that sounds pretty good and keeps me from having to do anything that's uncomfortable or going into my fear that might disrupt or whatever. And so that there's where the bullshit lives.
Right. Right. And I just, the word risk keeps coming up. Like there's, you know, when we get rid of the bullshit and actually take those actions, we run the risk of alienating people and, you know, having relationships fall apart or realizing, oh shit, I don't actually like the work I'm doing anymore. Or, you know, as we wake up and become conscious to all of this, there definitely is a risk.
It's just change. It's just unknown. It's change. I don't know what that might be. I know what I've got now. I may not be happy here.
Right. But I know it.
But I know it. So yeah, change is uncomfortable. I just expect it. Even the good stuff, like even like the just, it can be really exciting. Like, I want to go on it. Like there's at this stage of the game for me now, it's I'm married, I got a child, and over the last few years, I've really groomed myself to want to just be with my family. Mm. And my community of male friends is, it's like that used to be really strong. It's not as strong anymore. And so when I say, I come up with ideas for us to go travel together, I've got a couple of buddies that we go around the world and do stuff together, but it's like, it's still this pinch like, I don't know. I don't want to do that. I don't know. I just start coming up with bullshit.
Uh-huh.
Even though it's something that I want and it'll be fun and, you know, and I know it feeds me and it's the best thing for me. And it's just like, it's change. It's just uncertainty.
Yeah. Yeah. And interesting too, that you, and I'll say for myself too, you know, being a coach, doing lots of therapy and all kinds of other things, that we still, it's still there.
Still there. Still there. And I've found that as I've gotten further into my practice with people, the less I engage the bullshit, the better. The bullshit loves to talk about itself.
Yes.
Let me show up with my coach today and we can just talk about my bullshit instead of what's the thing you're going to do right now to move through the bullshit and take action. And it's very, guys that work with me know it's very common that it's a phone, it's usually a phone call or something. It's like, great, do it right now. Put me on mute and go do it right now. So this idea that we need to process the bullshit, we need to understand the bullshit, and we need to go deeper and really get to the core of the bullshit. It's just bullshit. It's just more bullshit.
More bullshit.
It's just more bullshit. And I'm not saying that all process is bad or whatever, but in these particular cases where there's the thing that I want and I'm just afraid to do it, and I got this story, I don't need to know your story. Just go do it. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about your life on the other side of doing this thing.
Yeah. Right.
Let's see who you are.
Let's see what happens. And then we can talk about that.
Yeah. And a lot of times is that we've all been that kid out on the end of the diving board where we're telling ourselves all this bullshit about if I dive in, the shark's going to get me or the kids or whatever. I'm going to just shit my pants or whatever it is. Right. And it's just like, why don't you dive in and then we'll talk about where you are. Let's talk about your life then, because that's where we transform. That's where we transform.
You may not be able to talk about it after.
Let's see. And that, I think that's the right. You're a parent. I'm a parent. Our kids are great at giving us these reasons that are completely asinine. Like they really believe that they're going to die. And we know as a parent, like they're okay. And I think as our job as coaches is to see like, oh, you're completely fine.
Yeah.
Your ego is that, you know, you're risking your self image, that kind of thing, but you're completely fine. So I don't need to go on this ride with you that you're really in danger. You're not in danger. So go do that thing because you're really not in danger. And let's talk about it.
Right. If you really are in danger, if there's an actual physical danger or danger to your life, that's another thing. But
that's a total other thing. But all the stuff we're talking about here is all usually egoic. It's all like, I don't want to look stupid. I don't want to fail and feel bad. And, you know, it's like, I don't want to be uncomfortable. That's it.
Yeah. I was just thinking, my son came into my room the other night. He was supposed to be sleeping and he was like, Mom, I just had a bad dream and there were monsters and they were chasing me. And, you know, I consoled him for a little bit and was like, oh, okay, that sounds scary. And then I said, you know what I heard? And it's somewhere I did hear this. I think actually maybe Pema Chodron, somehow I heard this and I'm not sure exactly what the context was, but I said, you know what I heard is that if you're being chased by monsters, if you run, if you turn around and you face them and you make a really scary face back at them, then they'll get really scared and run away. And he closed his eyes and he said, I just did it. And I said, what happened? He was like, well, they hit themselves in the face. They did like face palm and then he just ran away screaming.
That's it. You don't need to go like, oh, what's the monster mean? You know, we don't need to know. It's
who
just,
are you? And
yeah. What facet of my personality has shown up as the monster? It's like, as you're doing that and you spend the next 20 years going through that process, you miss out. You don't do the thing that you really wanted to do. And but the big point that you just laid up is you turning right into it is the lesson. And the coach I'm working with now, Phil Stutz, is the same thing. Like he says it in the calls, like, okay, what's the thing that scares you? Okay, yeah, okay, that's what we want to do. We want to do that right now. I'm like, gosh, shit. Like, I thought you were going to give me a cool shortcut hack thing to move around, get around it. No. We want to go right into it. Let's do it right now. It's like, but that's it. That's the work.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about so many of the conversations I've had and guided my clients to have as well, where, I'm about to say it. And then all of a sudden the heat in my body and that, like, this just might ruin everything. Mm. And how often on the other side of that, you know, there's more intimacy, more connection, more trust, more the relationships I have. I actually just have a friendship too, where we just got into it and had a really hard conversation. And, you know, now I actually have this trust that we'll stick around for the hard stuff as opposed to, oh shit, if anything hard comes up, I'll go, you know, which right. In a marriage or in a long-term relationship, if you haven't faced some of those fears or demons or whatever, there's kind of still like this walking on eggshells and you don't ever get to relax around each other. It's like, well, if we talk about this or if I bring up this fantasy or that, then it just might end us.
If I bring up the money thing, it's avoiding the truth. It's choosing this illusion of comfort versus the truth.
Yeah.
And I found that just, it's really just expansion. It's like, oh, it's, I want to be in a relationship where I know we can talk about this stuff and we'll be okay. We've got the tools. We can resource ourselves if we're not. Those are the relationships I want to be in.
Yeah.
I've been in relationships where I will bring stuff up and it's like, that's it. That was it. The other person did not choose the growth path. He chose the comfort path. You know, it's like, we got to make sure we don't talk about this stuff. Let's just keep sweeping shit under the rug. More bullshit, right? And it's heartbreaking, but at the same time, I committed years ago that I was on this growth path. I just wasn't going to tolerate the bullshit anymore.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it happens. It sucks, and it happens.
It does suck when it happens. Yeah, right? I mean, it's not like we get to escape pain. Right. I think there is, like you said, you know, there's this kind of illusion of comfort. And yet the, you don't even know how to put words to this, but that feeling of comfort, that's just like, it's either like a sickly sweet feeling or this kind of just underlying anxiety where it's like, it's, I'm comfortable, but it feels like hell.
But I could scream at any moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. Climbing the walls. I think that's just what a lot of people grow up with. They grow up in that tension. They grow up watching their parents not deal with things.
Yeah.
They grow up hearing bullshit excuses from people that they look up to, and that's the game that they take on. And I think things are evolving, and more people are learning, like, I can actually tell the truth. And as you said, the relationship can be stronger as a product of that.
Right. Or as you said, it isn't, it falls apart. And yet, you know, ideally we support each other to grow, but if it does fall apart, then often what I've also worked with a lot of men after divorce and long-term relationship and, you know, relationships have fallen apart. And yet then there's this, okay, who am I really? You know,
who am I really? And what am I doing? And I think if that's what I just alluded to, that choice that I made, I recognize that it's a very polarizing choice. And I think that if you're unconscious of that, then relationships are really hard.
Yeah.
Because it's wondering, it's like you don't know what you're dancing with your partner, but you don't know what song they're dancing to. Mm. You don't know where the beat is. And so there's no way to really find the flow and the groove with that person. But if you know that that you guys are orienting towards growth and truth and expansion, then it's like, okay, well, we can figure this out. I don't necessarily have to have the answers, but we can figure this out because I see a greater possibility for us here and that we can go through conflict or we can go through this and that. And there's the possibility of us getting stronger on the other side.
Yeah.
Which is far different than, hey, let's talk about this. This is difficult for me. And the other person just goes away.
Right.
You know?
Right.
It's like, oh shit, what just happened there? But right. I think that for the guy listening, if chances are, if he's listening, that he's interested in his own growth, then it's also looking through the lens of what relationships in my life align with that growth philosophy.
Yes.
And where am I hiding out? This is what we typically do. We hide out. Mm-hmm. We tell bullshit, right? But it really is like a sense of hiding out. I'm not being honest about who I am, what I care about, what I want. And that's the part that's far more draining, I think, in a chronic state than it is in some kind of a bump in the road where we come together and tell the truth and it's a sweaty, uncomfortable conversation. But then there's another possibility from there.
Right. And then there's aliveness, and then there's actual, here we are together. Though I was just wondering, you know, I think about a business situation or a work situation, if you have a boss or somewhere where there's a power dynamic, right, where something isn't working for you, you're hiding or you're unhappy. And, you know, I focus a lot on relationships, but also there's that success aspect. And I know you do too. And how to have the kind of success you want that includes not only, you know, financial or status or whatever, but also your own fulfillment. But there is a power dynamic, and there's something on the line where if you go have a certain conversation with your boss, you know, you could be fired, or you could not have that income anymore that you're depending on for you and your family. So
right.
I'm curious what you'd say in that situation.
I don't know. I'll be honest. I've not worked for anybody else since I worked in an art supply store when I was in college, and I didn't do very well at that either. No. I've always done best when I work for myself, and people I tend to coach are people that work for themselves. And I don't think that's an accident that I work with people in that domain, but I still think that it's gotta be a case by case basis. It's gotta be led with curiosity and hey, I've got a story that if I were to do XYZ that it would be looked down upon. Is that true? Like, we can always go, can we go check these things out with our partner or our boss or whatever? Like, that's a great place to start, just to go check out the story. If I'm talking with somebody and it's like, why can't you go do XYZ? Well, then I get the story, and then I'm like, well, why don't you go check it out and see if that's really true? Yeah. And the other person would be like, I think it's a great idea. That would open me up to do ABC. And that's happened more often than not, is that they just, so it's not like, hey, I'm doing blah, 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 and here's an ultimatum and F you. What would happen? What's possible here?
Yeah. And it also reminds me of, you know, how important communication is, and that there are all different styles of communication, and you could go to your boss if you have one and say something really aggressive or, you know, unconscious, or you could actually bring that curiosity to, hey, there's something I've been wondering about, or something I've been thinking, or something I think would actually serve not only me, but you and our company, and right, to actually figure out, okay, now that I'm going to move through this fear, right, and take a next step, how do I actually want to do it?
Yeah. And I think that's a great, you know, this segues into a part of the conversation where the guys that I work with are not looking at life through the lens of like, how do I be a better worker?
Right.
Or how can I be a good coach? Or how can I be a good husband or a good man? Those are all roles.
Yeah.
And so the ones that I work with are looking at things through the lens of like, what's exciting for me? What's the contribution I want to make? Do I see an opportunity to serve? Do I see an opportunity to make things better? So they're already on a path of initiating ideas and engaging things and bringing things to the table instead of waiting to be told what to do and looking for the criteria so they get it right. And okay, I take my wife out to eat once a week, and then I go down on her for 5 minutes, and then I do this. Like, it's just like this, it's just bullshit. It's another form of bullshit. So I think that's another flip there of, are you, you know, asking ourselves, am I doing this to be a good whatever, you know, like a good worker, or a good executive, a good husband, a good father, and then instead shifting into a more creative mindset, which is, what am I here to experience? What am I here to create? How can I contribute? How can I serve?
Yeah.
Much more proactive. And those are the guys that goes places. Those are the guys that make things happen in the world. So if you're sitting there and you're wondering why you've plateaued in your career or your relationship, a lot of times it's because you've just stuck to playing the role instead of asking those bigger questions and then engaging it.
Right. And trying to be good or good enough as opposed to, right, what about me? I mean, I work with so many men who, actually, I had a coaching session yesterday. It was really powerful with this man who's dating, and he kept turning his attention to how, which was awesome actually, because he's at the point now where he sees how amazing he is and how good he could be for her and how loving he could have been for this woman who, you know, cut it off. And so he was seeing his own amazingness, which I thought was incredible. But I also picked up on the fact that he kept focusing on who he could be for a woman, which is a great first step, but he was leaving himself out and not really looking at, I get to receive too, right? Like, I get to have an amazing life. I get to be loved. I get to be supported. I get to be held in my vulnerability. I get to have a woman who wants to have hot sex with me. So it was a really interesting shift for him to start to look at. And it took, you know, it was a couple times of pointing it out. And finally he was like, oh my God, right. It's like a blind spot that he doesn't even see, that his attention just keeps like water beating off the surface, right? Of
like he's more focused on the pursuit instead of the receiving aspect? Or what do you, I want to make sure I understand.
Well, he was more focused on, I mean, at first it was terror, right? Of even talking to a woman or initiating the conversation and not feeling good enough. Mm-hmm. Now we've worked together and he's gotten to this place where he's like, oh yeah, this is why I am awesome. This is why I'm an incredible man. And so it's not necessarily focused on the pursuit. I think some people might look at that and say, okay, great. You know, you're exactly where you need to be. You know how amazing you are. So now just go out and have these conversations. But his attention was then focused on, it was almost more like, how can I make this woman happy? How can I be good enough for her? Still, it was like this subtle.
Still trying to get something.
Yeah.
Still trying to perform or something like that.
Right. And where those can kind of creep in the cracks and we don't even realize that that's running us, as opposed to, oh, is this woman going to be a match for me? You know, is she able to have the depth of love and conversation that I want to have? I mean, the men I work with, right, go deep. They don't want that kind of surface, shallow, hi, honey, I'm home. Oh, good. How's your day? Blah, blah, blah. You know, that, again, bullshit.
Right. Yeah, and I think it's a willingness. Are we willing to be hated and misunderstood?
That feels like a punch in my gut.
It's if I'm going to do whatever it takes to avoid that, then I will design my life to play in bounds.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Like if at all costs, I got to make sure that I am not hated and I'm not misunderstood.
Then
I stay in the good box.
Right.
And it's different than being an aggressive jerk, right? Like going out and trying to hurt somebody. But there's, I notice this is part where it's like, oh my gosh, I got to make sure I'm not misunderstood and I'm not, you know, that leads to somebody hating me or whatever. But then what I imagine, or when I actually really sink into that and really feel it, there's a thing, there's like, oh, well, that's where the freedom is.
Mm. Right.
If I'm not worried about that, then I get to really show up and orient my life around what it is that I'm trying to create and how I want to serve, how I want to impact, et cetera, et cetera. And I just let go of this defense position.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the edge I'm playing at these days, is noticing, like, I can feel there's still this like sagging sense of holding back. And it's because I'm afraid of being hated and misunderstood.
Uh-huh.
Like I'll watch somebody like Louis C.K. and he's one of my favorite comedians. It's one of the things, like, I just remember his latest special, and he comes out and he talks about this extremely polarizing, highly controversial topic, comes right out of the gate with it. And I just remember, like, wow, the freedom. That was the first thing that struck me. It was like the freedom. It just wouldn't hurt him. He just dropped a grenade in the room. And he knew that it was going to invite a bunch of stuff, but he wasn't going to allow that to impact him. And he had something to say.
Yeah.
And so I knew that that's not my playground. I don't go into those topics and I don't go into that place to try and stir up trouble like that. But yeah. What I appreciated was that there was a sense of freedom there for him, that he was not going to hold back from what he really wanted to say.
Yeah.
And there were laughs there, but there was also, I think, the great comedians and the great thinkers get us to think too. They get us to see things from a different perspective.
Yes.
And so to me, that piece there is like, oh, that's everything. That freedom is hanging on this thing of like, I got to make sure I'm not hated or misunderstood. Well, what happens when I let that go and things open up?
Woo. I can feel the burn of that one and where I still do that, where I still play that way sometimes of, right, I don't want to say that thing, or I don't want to be misunderstood. Or I had an experience yesterday where I did something and I got a response of, wow, that was different. Or that was, it was really this weird, simple thing. Like I bought concert tickets and then someone said, wow, that was a lot more expensive than I thought it was going to be. And I just had this wave of shame go through my body, right? And realized, oh, this is such a simple thing, but I took an action without checking in with someone, because I was like, I really want this. I want to go. It makes total sense to me. I have a, my kid's going to be taken care of. I don't need a babysitter. All this bullshit, all the bullshit's cleared out of the way. I'm just going. Mm-hmm. And then someone's response was, oh, that was different, or that was not what I expected. And actually, it turned out that it wasn't even that negative of a response, but my internal experience was, I just did something wrong. I just disappointed someone. And it was actually an awesome opportunity for me to just feel it and be willing to burn away, the shame of, oh, what I do is not always going to make someone else happy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, there's also just an empowered response there. I think part of this, we come back to our conversation around the bullshit. There's the thing that I want, and then there's where I am, and then there's something to go through there. Usually when we're imagining these scenarios where the sky is falling because of whatever.
Because of what we do.
We don't see ourselves as empowered. Yeah. We don't see ourselves as able to make a choice. So everything has to be perfect right now so that we protect ourselves from some kind of uncertainty. But future self is going to be able to respond and be able to say something. And so to me, it's always, what's that empowered response? Oh, well, I can just check in with a person and be like, what's up? Like, help me understand what's going on here.
Yeah.
Is $15, $20 a deal breaker for you? Like, we can work this out. And that's where the confidence comes. Like, we can work this out. Whereas conflict comes up. Oh shit. Cannot handle this. Over. I was teaching somebody to surf yesterday, and we were just in the water, and the waves weren't that big, but they were powerful. And this person was kind of freaked out by the power in the water. And I just said, so what can you do? Let's talk about what you can do here. And it was different than, oh my God, I'm going to die. I'm going to die. I'm going to get drowned. I'm blah, blah, blah. And I was like, what can you do? You can duck under the water. You can do this. You can turn your body this way, that way. You can do it. And it suddenly became an active, creative conversation instead of, here's all the terrible things that might happen.
Right. What are your options? And how
so that's the pivot.
Yourself?
That's the pivot. What can I do? What's the thing that I can do in this moment?
I like that. I like that a lot. Yeah. I also, one of the things I work with men in one of my programs, I call it ABC communication, where it's kind of a similar thing, but bringing this into the realm of relating with people or women or whatever, where I find that, if a man says something, we'll call that A, right? He says, oh, you look beautiful today. And then B is her response, which is, you're a fucking pig. Or I can't believe you're saying this to me, right? Which is his worst fear and usually doesn't happen. But, she could be dismissive or offended or any of those things. And a lot of men stop at B and they're like, whoop, game over. I guess I'm out of here.
Right.
But then that there's actually an opportunity for C, which is to say something of like, oh, wow, I'm totally surprised at your response because that wasn't my intention at all. Or, wow, that was a pretty strong response for this comment. Like, what happened for you? Or, any number of things. There's no script, but any number of things to actually not have a person or a woman's communication be the end. Be that a kind of wall instead of a doorway to walk through of like, oh, where are we going to go from here? What do I do?
It just, I think, you know, I can get curious here. I can get defensive and tuck tail and run.
Yeah.
Or I can be like, oh, what was that about? Help me understand that. Like, genuinely, not like, what the fuck was that about?
Right,
but
exactly.
Just like, oh, interesting. Yeah. What was that? That's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
And it takes a lot. That's the mean. It's like, it comes back. It's like, I'm willing to be misunderstood.
Yeah.
I'm willing to be looked down on or whatever. It's like, just feel how expansive life gets from that place where I'm, her opinion of me doesn't decide who I am. And I would be full of bullshit if I told you that I didn't fall into this too, but this is where I'm playing these days. Like really, really expanding into that.
Yeah. I love it.
Like finding places. Maybe I'll try to offend you at some point in this.
I like that game. Like, could I actually, if I, let's try.
Could I offend Shane? I don't know if I could.
I don't know if you could.
I could talk about.
You could probably hurt me sooner than you would offend me.
Yeah. I don't want to hurt you.
Yeah. So. Well, any last thing you want to leave guys with around bullshit and moving past bullshit?
Well, I think it is about responding, our response, right? So the thing that I'm taking away, I love the examples that you dropped in here, is that, oh, for any given situation that I'm telling myself I want something, and then here's the bullshit story that I have. What if she says this, or what if this happens, or what if that happens? There's an empowered thing. I can learn something there. And I think for a certain part of the population, they just do that anyway. They go into that thing anyway. But I think for the rest of us, we can learn that. We can learn that response. And it's not the norm. It's not what, quote, most guys do. They don't typically turn into the thing that they're scared to do. Mm-hmm. They back off. They go have beers together. And they come up with stories to collude with one another about why this thing is bullshit and blah, blah, blah. But it's really just they're all sitting around telling each other it's okay to be scared and we'll find a reason to justify being scared together.
Yeah.
So I would watch out for those things, for that kind of false sense of community or false sense of strength. Go find the people that are going to challenge you to go into those things that you really want to do.
That's
what I'm taking. And I just love that you've got these tools that you're talking about. That feels really exciting. Mm,
thank you.
I wish I'd known the ABC thing.
Well, now you do.
Now I do. See, everything, my whole life's changed.
Yeah. Maybe it will save you some suffering.
Yeah.
How do you want men to find you? Do you want men to find you?
I was going to make a joke.
I know. I was waiting for what we're
Just the New Man podcast. There's just tons of stuff on there. There's interviews with you on there. There's interviews with all kinds of people. Just go look for the New Man podcast anywhere where you get your podcasts. And then there's videos that I've been creating as well on YouTube. And those will kind of lead you into the world that I've created.
Awesome. Thanks for doing this.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
I'm so glad you joined us for today's episode of Man Alive. I hope it gives you a sense of what's possible and how good your life can be. If you like what you heard, I'd be so grateful for you to subscribe to Man Alive and write a quick review that helps men like you find us. And again, head over to shanajamescoaching.com/manalive to get outtakes, videos, and raw footage I only share there. These are some of the most interesting parts of these expert conversations. You can also grab your copy of The Unknown Power to accelerate your career and solidify your confidence with women, because the two are related, and I know you don't have to settle for one or the other. Join us each week for a new episode of Man Alive.